Myelin Oligodendrocyte Glycoprotein Antibody-Associated Disease, or MOGAD, is a condition where the immune system attacks the brain, nerves to the eyes, and spinal cord. The most common symptom of MOGAD overall is visual loss, where a person presents with pain with eye movement, progressive visual impairment, and on examination, we can see that their visual acuity, in other words, their ability to read the vision testing chart, is reduced. Other common presentations include spinal cord attacks, and when those occur, people have numbness, tingling, weakness in the arms and legs, depending on the level of the spinal cord involvement. And if the spinal cord is involved in the lower part, they may have difficulty passing urine and having symptoms of loss of bladder control. The third most common presentation is something we refer to as acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, or ADEM. And in this presentation, a person presents with confusion, sometimes even coma, often with multiple symptoms at the same time. So they may have the weakness that I described earlier, visual impairment, they may be off balance, and they may be unable to function neurologically in terms of normal responses, progressing, as I said, even into the severest of presentations, which would be coma. So nobody before their first attack knows they have it. MOGAD is, to the best of our ability, completely asymptomatic before your first attack. And that's really important because it raises the question of something having triggered that first expression of this disease. Patients don't tell me that they felt tired for a long time, or that they've been struggling in school, or that they've had these funny feelings in their hands or feet that made them feel numb or tingly. That's not the story we experience when people have their first attack of MOGAD. It all seems to start the day they present. And that's different from multiple sclerosis. In people with multiple sclerosis who don't know they have multiple sclerosis either until they have a first attack, if we talk to them about their lived experience in the year or two or even more before that event, they will often tell me, "I'm more tired than my friends. I have had brief things that felt funny to me. My hand went numb. I had trouble doing something. It lasted a couple of days, but I didn't think to talk to my doctor, or it wasn't severe enough to tell anyone. Or I remember 5 years ago, I couldn't see well in my right eye, but it got better over a week or two, and I didn't actually have an exam at that time." Those aren't the stories we see in MOGAD, and I think that tells me anyway that multiple sclerosis starts way before the first attack, and we have lots of reasons to believe that to be the case. Whereas MOGAD, at least the best we can tell right now, seems to start pretty acutely. We don't actually know yet how common MOGAD is, and the reason for my vague answer is because the diagnostic criteria were published in 2023, and therefore many, many clinicians around the world are now applying these diagnostic criteria and identifying children and adults who meet the diagnostic criteria for MOGAD. Really importantly, the diagnosis of MOGAD rests on the detection of antibodies or proteins in the bloodstream that target myelin oligodendrocyte glycoprotein, or MOG. It's required to have these antibodies to confirm the diagnosis of MOGAD. Testing for MOG antibodies has become available really only in the last 5 years, reliably, and in many parts of the world, still not easily accessible. So to answer the question, I think we need a little bit more time in order to identify individuals that meet the criteria and to be sure that the MOG antibody testing is available to their doctors and their communities. So the treatment of MOGAD is divided really into two main parts. Part one is treating the child or adult acutely. In other words, when they come in with that first event of visual loss, of confusion, or ADEM, as I explained, or with spinal cord symptoms. And that treatment is first, prompt recognition. Second, treatment with what we refer to as high-dose corticosteroids, also known as methylprednisolone, which typically works quickly and reduces the inflammation in the brain, the optic nerves, that's what controls vision, or the spinal cord. If that's not enough, we move quickly to other therapies and often use something called plasma exchange, which is kind of like dialysis for the bloodstream, where we take out of the circulation those MOG antibodies that we believe are contributing to the symptoms that that patient is experiencing. In addition to that, we can also acutely use a drug called tocilizumab, or medicines similar to it, that can be life-saving in someone who is in an extreme attack of MOGAD. We also use something called immune globulin, or IVIG, people may have heard it referred to. This can help both with the acute attack, but also moving into the sort of part B of MOGAD therapy, which is the patients that, for patients who have relapsing MOGAD. Not all patients will actually have a relapsing form of this condition. Some people will have one attack, and that appears to be the entire experience they have with MOGAD. For people who experience relapsing MOGAD, we want to prevent those attacks or relapses. And to do that, we can use immune globulin again, but this time in a monthly dose. Sometimes we use therapy that blocks one particular arm of the immune system, and we refer to this as anti-CD20 therapy, often called rituximab, as one option. And more recently, there are studies that are exploring whether medications such as tocilizumab, which blocks something called interleukin-6, or specifically interleukin-6 receptor, and whether those therapies might also be an option. That is very much under study. At this point in time, relative to other conditions, there are no specific treatments for MOGAD that have been approved through the typical regulatory process in the United States, the FDA, and in Europe, the European Medicines Agency, or EMA. All of our therapies right now are guided by specialists that have worked as a community to provide guidelines for the treatment of MOGAD at the present moment. So MOGAD is probably overall more common in children, but that depends on how you define common. So if we're asking how frequent is MOGAD when you compare diseases like multiple sclerosis or a relatively similar disease called neuromyelitis optica spectrum disease, if you compare those three, MOGAD would be the most common of the three in a child, whereas multiple sclerosis would be by far the most common of those three conditions in an adult. And I mention it that way because those three conditions can look a lot like each other at the beginning. If you look at all individuals diagnosed with MOGAD, and given what I mentioned earlier, which is that we're now recognizing more and more people with MOGAD because of the ability to actually test for the antibody and use diagnostic criteria, I would still say it's probably more common in children than adults, but that might change as more and more adult care providers recognize the condition as well. So there's a great deal of research ongoing right now about MOGAD. First and foremost is our ongoing research and collaboration worldwide with optimized therapy. So experiences of the providers in multiple countries, we communicate, we have a MOGAD international research community. We meet one Friday a month virtually with people from more than 40 countries participating, and we share our best practice and we guide the design of treatment trials that will ultimately give us very strong evidence for which treatments are best for people with MOGAD, in particular for people with relapsing MOGAD. We are also studying whether the MOG antibody, so the protein that is clearly important in this disease, many studies are ongoing to better understand what happens when you have MOG antibodies at the cell level. What does this protein actually do, and how does it turn the immune system on in such a way that the immune system attacks in the brain, the nerves to the eye, and the spine? And then finally, fundamental question, which requires that we all collaborate worldwide, is what triggers this disease? Is there an infection or an exposure that someone has in their environment that leads to this condition? Are there any genetic risks? So far, we've not found any. And how do we decide clinically which patient is likely to experience more MOGAD attacks and which patients are only going to ever have one? And of course, when we study those people who have one attack, what did their immune system do to turn this process off so that they don't experience more events? And can they teach us how to better care for those patients whose immune system did not figure out how to turn itself off and we have to help do it for that patient? MOGAD is rare overall, and there are many doctors around the world who would not be familiar with MOGAD as a diagnosis and would be unfamiliar with the different treatments and the strategies we use. So my response is anyone with a diagnosis of MOGAD, if possible, in their region or community, should be referred to either a child neurologist or an adult neurologist who understands this condition. There are people like myself that have studied MOGAD and related conditions, and we're referred to as neuroimmune specialists. And we make ourselves as available as we can be to provide advice, to counsel on webinars and sources of information, like we're doing now, and to guide other doctors who ask us to help them as they care for a patient in their practice. And of course, we see many patients ourselves. But the real answer is that when you have a rare condition that needs prompt therapy and prompt diagnosis, we need to be available to each other because it's not possible to have specialists everywhere. And so we need to be ourselves more virtually available in order to help children and adults with MOGAD wherever they happen to be cared for. Again, back to my beginning answer, given that MOGAD is a relatively recently described form of neuroimmune disorders, our depth of information is somewhat limited. What I've done, and others like me who have studied children, in my case, and others with adults, for many years who have multiple sclerosis, now what we know to be MOGAD, and other similar diagnoses, a lot of us have kept very careful records, stored biological samples with the permission of our families, took really careful and detailed photographs of the brain and spine, and have kept those in an organized manner, all of which we did with the full support and enthusiasm and consent of our children, teenagers, and their parents. And these generous families have allowed us to go back in time. So for example, I've been studying these conditions since 1999. And have had the privilege of being very well supported, initially by the Canadian Multiple Sclerosis Foundation and then others, and with many collaborators. And we've been able to look at children that we looked after many years ago, whom we've kept very close follow-up on over now over 25 years. So I can say that most patients with MOGAD do well. I can also share that relapsing MOGAD, of course, is a much more serious condition generally than people who have only one event. And I can say that when you have relapsing MOGAD, the most likely way that you're going to experience new attacks is having attacks on the eye with episodes of visual loss. And with current therapies, we seem to be doing better at suppressing those attacks than we did 20 years ago. Now, 20 years ago, we didn't know it was MOGAD. We didn't have the tool, the ability to measure the MOG antibody at that time. But we knew that the patients did not look like patients with multiple sclerosis. So we were managing our patients then as best we could, but not nearly as well as we are now because we can make the correct diagnosis. So my answer is that at this point, with proper therapy, most of my patients are actually doing really well. But what I don't know is how they will be in 10 and 20 years, and we're going to need to work as a community to really figure that out in the era of prompt diagnosis and available treatment. So one important thing about MOGAD, and this is true of multiple sclerosis and neuromyelitis optica spectrum disease and related conditions, is that there are communities that are available to support families who have recently been diagnosed. And these are wonderful groups that provide information, help people find doctors in their area to work with, provide patient days in different parts of the country in the United States and around the world to bring families together to share what they're going through and to provide each other support, and to have experts come and talk to these family groups in multiple ways. So the MOG project is very specific to MOGAD. The National Multiple Sclerosis Society provides a wealth of information as well, not only for multiple sclerosis, but related conditions. And the Guthrie-Jackson Foundation in particular has a wealth of information about neuromyelitis optica spectrum disease, as does the Samira Foundation and the Siegel Rare Disease Foundation. These are terrific resources for anyone who has entered into this world and is seeking additional information in order to both understand what they're going through, what their child is going through, and how to get the care they need. At the Johns Hopkins Pediatric and Adult Neuroimmune Program, we have specific expertise in MOGAD. Personally, I have been involved in the study of MOGAD for many years, and I led the creation of the 2023 International MOGAD Diagnostic Criteria. I currently serve as the research chair of the International MOGAD Consortium, and we meet every month as a community of over 150 members in over 40 countries to talk about what we experience in looking after MOGAD patients, where research is headed, how we can collaborate, how we can work as a community to better understand this disease, and how we can best care for children and adults living with MOGAD. Dr. Chen, who is my partner in clinic, has incredibly innovative research on the immune signatures of patients with MOGAD and related conditions, really delving into what is the immune system doing in these conditions and how can we better understand that in order to tailor our treatment even more specifically. On our adult side at Johns Hopkins, we have investigators that have created ways to measure the MOG antibody and are researching how to better understand what that protein does. We have world-class researchers who have studied the clinical features of MOGAD and have contributed to our understanding of how MOGAD affects the nerves to the eye and the spine in particular. And of course, we have an amazing care team that includes nursing, advanced practice nursing, physical and occupational therapy, social work, psychology, psychiatry, and neuropsychology to really address our patients holistically in order to optimize the care they need.